Allow this video to be your luminous guide, illuminating your path with wisdom and inspiration.
The simple thing right now that's a rage in the world is, if you come to our ashram, all the people there who are physically immensely active, eat 10 o'clock in the morning, 7 o'clock in the evening, 2 meals. How many doctors have been telling me that they will die of malnourishment, this will happen, that will happen, you must do this, you must do that. I eat only 1 meal a day most of the days. 1 big meal I eat and that's it. And doctors telling me, no, no, Sadhguru, the way you're traveling, this will happen, that will happen, you must eat at least once in 4 hours, something you must eat. I said, leave me alone, I'm doing fine. But now, a big university in America comes up with this called intermittent fasting. It's not nonsense, it's good, but they rediscovered something that we have known forever. Now everybody is saying there must be a 16-hour gap. Then all your ailments will go away. What the hell were we saying all these thousands of years? The simple thing is, there are many, many aspects to this, psychological, physiological. But now cancer is on the rise in the world. A cancerous cell is like a criminal in the society. All of us have in our bodies. Only if they become, their concentration becomes more than what they should be, or they gang up and locate themselves in one place, they become like organized crime. There are pickpockets in Kochi, I'm sure. Hello? There are small-time criminals, individually operating in twos and threes. We don't take it very seriously, we'll leave it because it happens. But suppose all 100 of them got organized into your organized crime, now we will crack down. Because we know now it becomes a threat to the society. Similarly, cancerous cells are like this. Criminals, they're moving around, doing some damage. Their only problem is, right now, they're generally eating about 8 to 12 times more than what the other cells are eating. So if you just give sufficient break between 1 meal and the other, most of them will die because they cannot survive. This is something we've been talking forever. But now they've discovered it with a billion-dollar research. And I've seen hundreds and thousands of people who just become healthy and well simply because they're not fueling up all the time when the tank is filling. In the yoga center, all the time people are physically active. So everybody is very hungry by the time it's 3:30, 4 o'clock in the evening, they're extremely hungry. But we learn to live with that because empty stomach and hunger are two different things. Hunger means your energy levels start dropping. But empty stomach is a good thing. In the yogic sciences, today modern science also is coming in line with this. But what we know by our experience, you will spend $1 billion to come there. Because research is all about how many million dollars, that's how it is. Your body and your brain works at its best only when your stomach is empty. So we always make sure we eat in such a way, how much ever we eat, our stomach must be always empty within 2 to 2.5 hours time maximum. So we go to bed hungry always. People think they cannot sleep. They can sleep. On an average, for 25 years on an average, I slept only 2.5 to 3 hours. These days I'm getting little lazy and sleeping anywhere between 3.5 to 4.5 hours in spite of the level of travel that I have. When I say level of travel, if I say my level of travel in the next few days, you will fall off your chair. Yes? Should I tell you? No, not necessarily. Because in the next 10 days, I'm in 5 different countries doing I don't know how many events, all kinds of events. So,
You are able to keep this up simply because you don't overeat. It's very, very important. Everybody eats two meals. I generally eat only one meal, 4:35 in the evening, because I don't like to sit in front of the plate and worry about how much to eat. I like to eat well. So, 4:35 in the evening, if I eat a meal, it's only next day. Is this enough? Am I looking okay? Hello? Because any correction and purification that needs to happen in the body, your stomach needs to be empty. It's very, very important. Otherwise, the purification on the cellular level will not happen. You pile up things and then you have all kinds of problems.
When you don't touch the food, you do not know what it is. If food is not good enough to be touched, I don't know how it's good enough to be eaten.
So we should not listen to our mothers and we should eat with our fingers, because touching our food helps us stay in contact with it.
You can… the cleanliness of your hands is entirely in your hands. The cleanliness of the fork is not entirely in your hands. And nobody else but you have used these hands. So, there is an assurance as to how clean or not clean it is right now. The fork, you do not know who's used it, how they've used it, for what they used it. And all they have to do is wipe it with a tissue and give it to you and it looks pretty clean. Above all, you don't feel the food. The first thing that's been taught to us is, if food appears in front of you, to hold your hands upon the food for a few moments, just to feel how the food is. If something appears on my plate, if I just feel this, I know what to eat and what not to eat, what I should not eat. I don't taste it and then reject it. I just don't eat, because my hands are the first level, not tasting in the sense the tongue tastes, but knowing the food. First thing is knowing the food. You want to know a person, you guys go and shake their hands. I'm usually avoiding that, but
that's a good strategy.
But the food that's going to become a part of you, first thing is your hands. Even if you physically don't touch it, just being conscious and being there, it clearly tells you how the food will behave within you. Whether this particular food on this particular day, should it go into you or not? Because every day your body is not the same thing. Every day, every moment, it's different. If you feel the food, you just know whether this food has to go into you on this day or not. If that much awareness is brought in, we don't have to go on telling people what they should eat. Every meal they must decide what they should eat in that meal. There is no one prescription that this is what you should eat for your life. That will feel too claustrophobic, that only this I can eat.
Your selection of food and consumption of food also must happen consciously. More than what you eat, how you eat it is also equally important. When I say how you eat it, these are all life substances. Every one of them had a life of their own, whether it's a plant, animal, vegetable, every one of them had a life of their own. Now in some way, you're making food out of it, you must consume it with utmost gratitude. If you approach it with a certain sense of gratitude and reverence towards the food that you eat, when I say reverence, it may feel like too much for you, but I'm asking you. Let's say we put you in a room and you had nothing to eat for 5 days. If God appears in front of you, what will you ask for? Food? So that's how important it is. You must understand the food on your plate is not just a substance. It is not a material, it is not a commodity, it is life. It is the life-making material for you. So you must treat it as such. Right now, when it's on the plate, when it's out there, it has no value, but the moment you consume it and it becomes your flesh and blood, now suddenly it's of immense value. Why do we live like this? It's very important when it comes on your plate itself, you must treat it as a part of yourself.
with great reverence, you must consume. Just the way you consume it, if you change that, food will behave very differently within you. This is what consciousness means. If people say your consciousness has no impact on your life, only chemical structures have impact, I'm very sorry for them, because that's not how life works. Human consciousness has a deep and profound impact on everything that we touch, especially the food that we are making another life as a part of ourselves. When we're doing such an act, it's very, very important we treat it with utmost gratitude and reverence.
I want to tell you, there is no such thing as good habit and bad habit. Habit means you are functioning unconsciously. If you are functioning unconsciously, that's a bad thing, because the whole thing about being human is we are capable of doing things consciously. That is the beauty of being human, that we can do everything consciously. What an animal does unconsciously, we can do the same thing consciously. We can eat unconsciously or we can eat consciously. We can breathe unconsciously or we can breathe consciously. Everything that we can do it consciously. The moment we do something consciously, suddenly that human being looks very refined and wonderful. Just because somebody walks and speaks consciously, doesn't he become a beautiful human being? Yes or no? That's all. So why is it that we are trying to develop habits as if there's a good thing? Habit means fixed realities where you don't have to think. You get up in the morning and it'll happen to you. No, don't try to automize your life. That is not efficiency, that is the efficiency of the machine. This one is supposed to function intelligently and consciously. Nobody is expecting it to function like a machine. So, about food and stuff, food must be suitable for the body that we eat. For? It is for the body. This is a building material for this body, the food that you're eating. What is the appropriate food? Unfortunately, it's all messed up right now. Traditionally, we ate very sensibly in this country, but these 1,000 years of innovations have brought other kinds of food cultures, and today the national diet is pizza or pasta. What is it? Which is one? I don't know. Both were competing. So, we are losing our sense about food. It's definitely time to look at what is the most suitable thing. If I go into that food, it's a very long process, but you must experiment with food. Not just by the tongue, but by the body. You eat something today and see, just learn to observe how agile and how active your body feels after eating this food. If it feels like it wants to go to the grave, that's not good food. If it feels like it wants to be alive after eating this, accept coffee, because that's a stimulant. If you eat food and your body feels very agile and alive, that means it's good food, body is liking it. If you eat something, it feels dull, that means it's not liking it, it's having difficulty with it, that's why it feels dull. So just on this basis, there's a much… I mean, this is a very simplistic way of putting it.
Now death is coming to you, this moment you're leaving. If this moment you can leave with a smile on your face, because most people cannot smile in their lifetime. Yes. People come in spring, they're walking outside, it's springtime, but you don't see a smile on their face. Everything in nature is smiling at them, but they are. So, can these people smile at the moment of death? No chance, isn't it? If someone has to smile at the moment of death, definitely he has a little more control, a little more mastery over life situations. Somebody dying in an accident may not say anything about the way he has lived. No. I might have lived a wonderful life, but today I'm driving and I'm doing 100 mph. And just one mistake, just one mistake, it can finish my life, isn't it? So that's got nothing to do with how I have lived my life. It's just one stupid mistake in driving process can take away life. Now when you're getting office or wherever, sitting quietly, smiling and dying is very difficult. Your body is still fully healthy, it doesn't die easy. Now it's burning, so burning has to kill you. But now, for somebody else, life is ebbing away for some other reason, either simply old age or whatever. The life energies have lost their vibrance. Now it leaves easily. There's no telling. Between you and your body, there is a certain bondage. If your life energies are right now very vibrant and there, it won't leave the body easily. Slowly, as time passes, as the lot of karma dissipates, then your life energies become dissipated. When they have lost their vibrance, it will slip out of the body so much more easily. So at that time, it is a much better opportunity for a person to die with a smile on his face. Because tearing of you and the body is very easy because it's become ripe. When it's not ripe, if you tear it in an artificial way, forceful way, now, smiling and going, it's difficult, but not impossible. Still possible. Now, suppose I crash my car and I'm dying. Everything is broken in the body. And now I think, oh my God, after all this life, I crash my car like this and laugh and die. Impossible. I would. If I die like that, you will see. In a crashed up car, you will still find me with a smile. Just look at the irony of it. How much man driving I've done today. Oh my God, I crashed my car like this. It's like, let's say, a great race champion. Just taking the car out of the parking lot, he crashed and he's dying. Maybe he will laugh. You know? Oh my God, after all the racing, here I am, pulling the car out of the parking lot and getting dead. Possible. But it needs a certain balance. But generally, when your life is vibrant, to tear it out of your body, there is violence in it, there is pain in it, there is suffering in it. So at that time, smiling becomes difficult. But smiling or not smiling is not the issue. It is just that with how much awareness you are living, that's the issue. Only if you are aware, you can smile, isn't it? If you are caught up in a situation, you cannot smile. The people on the street, especially in Europe, they are not smiling, not because something has gone wrong with their lives. They are not smiling because they are so badly caught up with whatever their nonsense. When they are so caught up, even if they are living a princely life, still they cannot smile because they are caught up with their life. Not because life is bad, is it? Not because they have not eaten, they are not smiling. They are not smiling because they are entangled with their life. Everything may be happening properly, but they are so entangled they cannot smile. So it is the entanglement. You will be able to smile at the time of your death or not smile simply shows the level of entanglement with life. Anyway, one day, I'm better off at it and die, isn't it? People were initiated by me, they must smile and die. They must smile and live. But they must definitely smile and die. You should die smiling.
There was a devotee whose name was Appattu Adigal in Tamil Nadu.
because he did not know Shiva directly, he started worshipping as Shiva's devotee. Thirunavakar sir was a great devotee of Shiva. So, Appatodigal, who was a rich man, started worshipping Thirunavakar sir as an embodiment of Shiva here. So he did much charity. Everything he named after Thirunavakar sir. He built a village tank, Thirunavakar sir tank. He built a cow shed for the stray cows, Thirunavakar sir cow shed. He built a temple, Thirunavakar sir temple. He had four sons. He named them Thirunavakar sir 1, Thirunavakar sir 2, Thirunavakar sir 3, Thirunavakar sir 4. This is a devotee. They are not reasonable people. So one day, one man came who looked like a Shiva Bhakta with ash on his forehead. He came and asked someone in the town, why is this tank named as Thirunavakar sir tank? They said, Appatodigal is a great devotee of Thirunavakar sir. So he calls everything Thirunavakar sir. All his four children are Thirunavakar sirs. His house is named after Thirunavakar sir. Everything is Thirunavakar sir. So this man said, can I meet him? Where does he live? They told him where he is. He went to Appatodigal's house. Appatodigal in the morning, after the cooking is done in the house, he's always waiting outside on the street. Anybody who comes, please, can you come and eat in my house? Anybody who passes this way, can you come and eat in my house? That's his joy. So he was waiting outside. This man came, a Shiva Bhakta. He thought it's a great benediction today that a Shiva Bhakta has come on the road. He welcomed him and took him inside. And he brought all his four sons, introduced them. Thirunavakar sir 1, Thirunavakar sir 2, Thirunavakar sir 3, Thirunavakar sir 4. His wife took his blessings and they wanted to serve him. He told the eldest boy to go into the garden and cut a plantain leaf and come to eat upon as you're eating here. The boy went out to cut a plantain leaf and when he opened up the tender leaf which is still rolled, when a guest comes of some significance, they don't serve in a leaf which is opened up. They want to take that leaf which is still rolled. So he wanted to cut that one. When he cut that one, a cobra came out of it and bit him in the neck. The boy came running home and in the garden he fell. And when his mother came, he said, a snake has bitten me. And he started frothing in the mouth and collapsed. His wife, totally distraught, called her husband. Appatodigal came and saw. And now, if this news spreads, the Shiva Bhakta will not eat in their house. The whole thing will be, whole hospitality will be gone. So he just took a mat, covered the boy, kept him in the garden. He told his wife, you should not show any sign of your grief. We must serve him first. After he leaves, we will handle our matters the way we have to handle it. The wife also agreed. They went and they prepared everything and they wanted to serve him. He wanted the whole family to come and have the meal with him. Then he asked, where is your eldest boy? Appatodigal said, no, he's gone out, let's have the meal. He said, no, where is the boy? It looks like you're hiding something. Appatodigal said, nothing to hide, let us eat. And why have you called all these four boys Thirunavakar sir, that man asked. Then immediately Appatodigal got angry. How dare you ask such a question? Do you know who Thirunavakar sir is? He's embodiment of Shiva here. you cannot talk like this. Then that man said, I am Trinaukar, sir. Then they fell at his feet and then Trinaukar, sir, asked, what happened to your son? Then the man said, he was bitten by a snake, but I did not want to disturb the hospitality. We wanted you to eat properly and leave. That is before they know he is Trinaukar, sir, just some devotee on the road. Then Trinaukar, sir, said, don't you do such a thing, bring the boy here. And using certain siddhi, he relieved the boy of the poison and brought him back to life, blessed them and went. These are different kind of people. They are completely different kind of people. They don't belong to this world. They just have one foot in this world. Their ways and their ways of living, the power with which they existed is completely otherworldly.
Young leaders that you've seen, where have been the susceptibilities, the vulnerabilities that over time they can work their way through, maybe giving them a little bit of guidance now can help?
I think the biggest problem with the so-called leaders of the day is we're not really producing leaders, we're just producing managers and supervisors. They come out as leaders and they suffer every moment of their life, this is what I'm saying. Because leadership doesn't come.
Among the pranic substances, there are a few vegetables which are very highly, highly pranic. It will bring you enormous amount of energy. At the same time, it keeps your nerves very, very calm.
All these things are relevant only for those people who are constantly striving how to better their life, how to perform a little better, how to open up another dimension of life. In the yogic culture, we classify foods into three categories: positive pranic food, negative pranic food, and zero pranic food. Positive prana means it adds a certain pranic energy to the system when you consume. Negative prana takes away energy from the system. Zero neither adds nor takes away, it's eaten for taste and lethargy. So, if you eat positive pranic food, energy will reverberate in a dynamic way. Particularly, some of the things were very, very positive are the ash gourd. The ash gourd is very, very highly positive. You… I think these days you're only hanging it in front of your house or breaking at three corners of the road and giving it to the buffalo, but you are not eating it. No, this is to be eaten. Because the vegetable has such high pranic energy, you put it in front of your home so that there is nice energy. But if there is so much energy to it, isn't it good to put it into you? It's good to put it into you, especially if you consume. There are many experiments on this. If you consume a glass of ash gourd juice every day, the number of cancerous cells in your body will dramatically come down. And you will see clearly the sharpness of your intellect will enhance itself.
Especially children must drink ash gourd juice. Daily consumption of ash gourd, you will see distinctly your mind seems to be clearer and sharper. This will be noticeable within a few weeks of consumption of ash gourd. You will see, morning you drink coffee, it gives you energy with agitation. You drink a glass of ash gourd juice, it gives you enormous amount of energy. At the same time, it keeps you very, very calm. One should consume it as much as you can. But those of you who are asthmatic, who are susceptible to colds and coughs, such people, if you consume ash gourd juice, you may immediately have colds because it cools the system. So if such a problem is there, such people should always add a little bit of honey or pepper to ash gourd juice and consume it. This will neutralize the cooling effect of the ash gourd to some extent.
When we were eating for survival, we ate whatever we could lay our hands on. Now that we have choices, we have to choose what's best for the body.
If we don't choose like this, then we will somehow live and go. All these things are relevant only for those people who are constantly striving how to better their life, how to perform little better, how to open up another dimension of life. If these concerns are there, then what kind of food or fuel you put into this machine is very, very important.
June 3rd, Sadhguru's first ever public event in Russia filled the Crocus City Hall with over 6,200 people. In fact, tickets were already sold out 2 weeks before the event. June 3rd, in anticipation of World Environment Day, volunteers trekked along the pathways in the Velingri foothills, cleaning up over 1,000 kilograms of plastic waste and other debris. June 5th, in over 400 locations worldwide, Isha Foundation and Rally for Rivers volunteers led awareness campaigns and cleanup drives.
Plastic is a classic case of who we are right now, how irresponsible we are as human beings, because out of many materials that we have developed on this planet, plastic is one of the most fantastic materials. I know a whole lot of people will get against me for this. I am saying this because a material that can be recycled thousands of times over and over again is a perfect material to make sure that what we use is in a cycle, that we don't have to continuously dig something new. We can use the same material for centuries if we handle it right. But we have handled it so irresponsibly, such a wonderful material has become poisonous, it has entered everything. If it has to change quickly, law has to come into place. That is why we are looking at single-use plastic ban.
June 8th to 10th, a group of nearly 80 leading HR practitioners, CEOs and entrepreneurs gathered at Isha Yoga Center for a unique 3-day leadership conclave presented by Isha Leadership Academy. Top industry leaders supported the program as speakers and resource leaders. June 10th, Isha volunteers and medical volunteers from Aravind Eye Hospital conducted free screenings for 122 residents of Nade Gaundanpudur village. The volunteers also conducted 12 eye surgeries. 2 more camps are already planned for July, with more to follow. June 12th, on a rainy Shivaratri night at Isha Yoga Center, brahmacharis were delighted to have a meet with Sadhguru after a gap of 6 months. From June 13th, 522 participants completed the 21-day Hatha Yoga program, which was supported by the Isha Hatha School of Yoga Teachers. June 17th, Sadhguru addresses army personnel at the Defence Services Staff College in Wellington, Kunur. June 19th.
If a human being has to function in extreme situations, the most important aspects are balance, clarity, and a limitless sense of exuberance towards what we're doing. The times of peace are the most difficult times, I believe, for the army. Because when there's nothing happening, you have to be alert and do everything that has to be done. When there's an enemy in the face, maybe our emotions take over and keep us up. But when there is nothing, still you have to do the same thing. This is where the real challenge is, and that is where the effectiveness of the forces are. So we would like to do our best to empower the forces with powerful systems like Angamardana.
June 20th. The third batch of BSF soldiers are in the process of a 2-week intensive Hatha Yoga teacher training program. Female BSF are also participating for the first time, making up 47 of the 100 participants. Touched by the unique ambience and energy of the Isha Yoga Center, the participants are giving themselves fully to the rigor of the intense schedule. June 21st, International Day of Yoga celebrations at Isha Yoga Center were held at Adiyogi, with soldiers of the BSF and students of Isha Vidya, Isha Samskriti, Isha Homeschool and other local schools. Around the world, over 850 sessions offered simple and powerful yogic practices to more than 100,000 people, including sessions in 12 states in India, and globally in Australia, Africa, US, Singapore, China, Malaysia, Oman, Lebanon, and more. Volunteers were specially trained to conduct the events. 60 sessions for defense personnel reached over 7,000 participants, and 16 sessions were held in prisons across Tamil Nadu. Over 1,000 further sessions are still to come.
Yoga means union. In some sense of union, if you are with everything else, no matter who you are, what is the nature of your activity, what you believe, what you don't believe, it will bring light to your life, for sure. So, as a part of this, on this International Day of Yoga, 21st of June 2018, being here with the Siachen warriors, it is my privilege and honor to be here among the bravest men of our country. And we are deeply humbled by many legends of your courage and things that have been done here. I think if we bring this in its right perspective to people like you who are every day put through rigors of extreme weather and extreme levels of activity, it will be of immense help. It is immensely a proud moment for us to be here among you, because most of the nation, unfortunately, does not know what men like you are going through to keep the nation safe and well. All the activity and achievements that we have in our lives are rooted in your service and sacrifice. Without your service and sacrifice in the nation, whatever else we are doing would be meaningless. So we bow down to you on this day, this International Yoga Day. Being with you is a great privilege and pleasure.
June 24th, on the occasion of the 19th anniversary of the Dhyanalinga consecration, multi-religious and devotional chants were offered throughout the day by Isha Brahmacharis and residents, Isha Samskriti students and guests.
When disembodiment happens, naturally every being moves towards this river. River is a stream of energy. Suppose you do Kala Bhairava Shanti, all the related people will benefit from that. If one dissolves in the river, you become that energy. If you cross, you go to another realm where beings will hang on. See, in my personal experience, when you leave the body, depending upon what level of evolution you are in, how thin or thick your casing is, accordingly, things happen. If something is, let us say, your casing or your bubble is too thick, it cannot break, it will go to the river and bounce back. What is the river? River is a stream of energy. A kind of energy which is neither life nor death, but a completely different kind of energy, which for lack of words, we can say a kind of energy which saves you, dissolves you, so it is called as vaitarni in Indian tradition. Vaitarni means it is a savior, one who is good at saving you. So what is the saving? It is not a physical river, it's a metaphorical expression, but there is a stream of energy. When disembodiment happens, naturally every being moves towards this river. Some will bounce back, some will soak in it, some will easily cross it.
Some.
Just dissolve right there.
Well, if you bounce back, one will have a rebirth. If one dissolves in the river, you become that energy. If you cross, you go to another realm where beings will hang on. Depending upon the nature of who they are, what their qualities are, what is the dominant quality, that will play. If they're very joyful, they will become ecstatic. They're miserable, they become very miserable. Like this, this is being normally referred to as hell and heaven, but essentially what's happened is, your quality, because you have no discriminatory mind, it gets exaggerated. So if somebody crossed the river or somebody bounced back, these two people you can help. If they have bounced back or if they've still not crossed the river, let's not say bounced back, they've still not crossed the river, now you do Kala Bhairava karma. Now they might have, you don't know for sure, they might have crossed the river, but still because of the thickness of their shell and their own attitudes, they may be going through this in an unpleasant manner. You want to bring some pleasantness, you want to bring some shanti to them. So you want to shave off one layer of their nonsense, whatever, maybe some unpleasantness will go away and pleasantness will happen. This is all the effort that you're making. If they're already pleasant, you still want to shave off one layer so that they will cease altogether. As unpleasantness is a bondage, pleasantness is also a bondage. Unfortunately, pleasantness… with pleasantness, people take more time to realize that it's a bondage. With unpleasantness, very easily you realize it's a bondage. So, you are trying to bring some pleasantness, but for sure you don't know. Maybe your grandfather or whoever else has already dissolved, maybe there's nothing to do. You don't know, but you still do as a duty so that in case he needs it. In case somebody else… see, this is… once you do this work, this is not only individual, because there is a certain runanubandha which connects people. Suppose you do Kala Bhairava Shanti for your grandfather, but he doesn't need it, he's already gone. Now, your grandfather's brother may be there, whom you don't care about, but he may benefit. So, people connected with that kind of runanubandha may get helped. Somebody else who is not even your relative may get helped. So, this has been kept as a culture that you must keep doing Kala Bhairava Shanti. So, shanti is done more as a kind of an effort. If any help is needed, we want to provide that for our ancestors, for our forefathers, or our grandfathers, or fathers, or mothers, or whoever. It doesn't matter whether your ancestors are hanging around there or not, we don't know. Maybe they've dissolved, maybe they've attained to mukti, maybe they're come back and reborn and again, it doesn't matter what, you keep doing it so that all the related people will benefit from that. Pitrupaksha means… Pitru means doesn't just mean your father or your grandfather. Everybody who is the source of our existence is our Pitru. So you want that to happen. To all the people connected, it doesn't matter, we liked them, we didn't like them, we knew them, we did not know them, but all related people to whom we can do something, we do something.
He fell ill, but they couldn't figure out what is wrong with him. Then he saw a man with a very long face and great misery. enhanced. One point in mind is something that nobody can stop. If you want to evolve above the intellect, it needs a conscious effort. 500 years ago, there was a city of my forefathers who were kings in that area. This city was the richest city on the planet 500 years ago. Please look it up, it's called Hampi. And suddenly one day Krishna Devaraya fell ill. That was the king's name. He fell ill. And physicians came and examined him in many ways, but they couldn't figure out what is wrong with him. But he was sinking away. Nearly at the doors of death, then he called for his friend and advisor, whose name was Tenali Ramakrishna. Tenali came, and he's no physician. He didn't know what to do. So the king sought his help, but he doesn't know what to do, he's not a physician. So confused, he walked away into the town and he was walking around in the marketplace. Then he saw a man with a very long face, in great misery, and angst. Tenali went up to him, "Hey, what's wrong? Why are you looking like this?" He said, "I am in the sandalwood business. Because a large stock was available somewhere, I took a huge debt and bought this entire sandalwood. Now if I don't sell quickly, I will be finished. People who have lent me money are not going to leave me alive. The only way I can sell this sandalwood is the king must die." When kings die, always the cremation was done with sandalwood. Nobody else can afford it. So he said, "Unless the king dies, I'm finished." Tenali looked at him, the intensity of his misery and angst. He said, "Wait a minute." He went home, got the money and he bought all the sandalwood. The man was very happy and the king recovered. It's not a joke. You must understand, in moments of anger, in moments of hatred, in moments of fear and angst, your mind becomes one-pointed. A one-pointed mind is something that nobody can stop. Right now, everybody is in this mode, can't point at anything. Because of that is one big confusion. If you have a one-pointed mind, there is nothing which can stop that. This was one of the important aspects of Gautama's expression, that he brought this into people's lives. You can take charge of your life if you take charge of your mind. I'm asking you also, if you take charge of your psychological process, you being blissful, is it a challenge? You're trying to take charge of somebody else's mind. One day, Shankaran Pillai and his wife went to the marriage counselor. So Shankaran Pillai introduced and said, "We really have a wonderful marriage because we have such a fantastic partnership and I'm the silent one." So this whole process of rising above the mind, which means a Buddha, becoming a Buddha, you must understand that's not his name, his name is Gautama Siddhartha. Buddha is a state, that means you're, if you're above your intellect, you're a Buddha. If you're in the intellect, you're a non-stop suffering human being. If you're below the intellect, we can call you a Buddhu. So, as evolution As creatures, we were below the intellect. Slowly, we evolved into the intellect. Now, if you want to evolve above the intellect, it needs a conscious effort. Don't wait for Mother Earth to do it for you. It may happen after million years, but you won't be there.
You should download an app that we have. It's a free app, anybody can download. It's called Sadhguru app. Here there is a practice called Isha Kriya. This is a simple way of bringing awareness to what is your body and what is you, what is your mind and what is you. Once there is a tiny little bit of space between you and your body, between you and your mind, this is the end of suffering.
Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to not miss any new content and invite your friends to join us on this learning adventure.